was very interested in applications of technology to ways that really improve and transform our lives in some way. And when I was at Tesla, I got very interested in applications of AI towards autopilot, and then went on to also explore other applications of AI, specifically in human-machine interface, in virtual reality and augmented reality. And so this is sort of where the AI journey began, and I was starting to get very interested in more general and broad applications. And I started to believe that, you know, this development of general artificial intelligence would be the most transformative technology that we would ever build. And
when you say transformative, like, what does that mean for you? You know, what sort of potential gets you excited?
It means like electricity. That, you know, really transforms every aspect of our lives and the social fabric, really the way we live in every way, and hopefully in a way that's good and it benefits us all. That's why OpenAI got started.
So tell me a little bit about, I'm sure everyone in the audience has heard of ChatGPT, which was launched, I guess, in November of last year. And I'm guessing many people in the audience, if not their teenagers, have played around with it. Tell us a little bit about the process of bringing something like that into the world. I know with that, with ChatGPT, it was maybe a little bit of a surprise, the response that you got. Tell us what that process was like in terms of, I mean, that was really the first. Well, you had launched things to the public before, the first one that went viral in the way that we really saw. Was that surprising to you? And what was it like to be responding to that inside the company as all that was playing out?
Yeah, so right now, ChatGPT is a product that people use, but in fact, it started as a research project. As you might know, these large language models that we have developed have a tendency not to be very truthful, which is not unlike humans. Humans tend to make up a lot of stuff. But we also have very high expectations of technology, and we want it to always tell us the truth. And so, you know, we started this research project to make these models more robust and more truthful. And the research eventually evolved into building this dialogue interface, because dialogue is really special. You know, it's the way that we interact with one another, and it's a way to kind of give feedback to one another. And so, you know, if I'm saying something that doesn't ring true or you're skeptical of, then you can question me about it, or you can correct me. So it's very powerful in that sense, and we wanted humans to be able to give this feedback to the models. And that's why we started to interact with the model in dialogue form. And along the way, we were making a lot of progress, and we decided that actually we want more people to give us feedback to make the model more robust and better at what it's doing. And so we released it as a research preview, not as a product, as a way to get broader feedback from different people beyond just our small company. And to our surprise, in just a couple of days, we had a million users, and it went really viral. And we found out that people are really excited to talk with AI and to interact with it. So that was a big surprise. And of course, we had to, you know, scramble, get more GPUs, and make the system more reliable so people could play more with it. But now, you know, we're at the point where we can use this feedback to make the model better, more reliable, more likely to do the thing that you want it to do.
How challenging is it to get a system that has been trained on things like Reddit forums to be truthful? I feel like, you know, there's certainly a component of the internet that is, you know, less than truthful. And I'm curious how you've thought about, you know, finding a way to, you know, when we are using something like Reddit as this training data and other things like that, like, yeah, what does that say about humanity then, that we're seeing that truthfulness reflected back to us?
It's quite interesting because, you know, we deal a lot with issues of bias and misinformation and what we call hallucinations, which is the tendency of the model to make up things. And they're all very human problems, issues that we deal with in society every day. But somehow we have this expectation that some really distilled technical solution is going to address these problems with technology. And that's really not the case. They're all incredibly complex issues. And part of it is because of the data that is trained on, which is data that we have all developed. But also part of it is just the general intelligence of the model, where it's not been trained to do a specific task. It's really just been trained to predict the next word in a sentence. So not, you know, to predict it safely or reliably, just to predict the next word. And so that's incredible that it's able to, you know, write poetry and do math and write code and do all these other things when it's not been trained to do any of them. But at the same time, whenever you have something so general and so powerful, with it also comes the possibility that, you know, it has severe limitations. The reasoning capability was something emergent in GPT-4.
Yeah, the reasoning capability feels so interesting too, just in the sense that, you know, it feels like there's a component there of kind of common sense, which we associate with sort of how a human would understand the world, and the idea that these systems have gotten to that point without necessarily being able to see what happens when you do drop a ball that you're holding, or, you know, all these things that we sort of understand in a very natural way about the world. Yeah, was that surprising to you?
You know, we had tested GPT-4 on academic benchmarks, and we expected it to be really good, but we just were not extracting the smartness through problems. And so we were very curious about what's going on. But this is actually not unlike what happens in reality. Like when you meet someone at a party, you probably don't talk about, you know, if you don't know anything about their profession, let's say they're a lawyer, you can't quite extract how smart they are in their field unless you know something about it. And so GPT-4 is not different in that sense, where it took someone that knew a lot about bio or, you know, math or another topic to really extract how these capabilities of the model to reason across different domains.
It's so interesting to think about that way in which the sort of machine and the human kind of empower each other in that way, when you have that sort of interplay, which of course makes me think about jobs. And I'm certainly curious on your thoughts on whether I will have a job in maybe 5 years. That'd be nice to know. But also just curious your thoughts on jobs generally as you look maybe 5 years out. You know, are these machines going to be our friends? And in what situations do you think they'll be helpful or potentially transformative in ways that could have negative effects?
Yeah, so in a way, these technologies have already changed the nature of many jobs. Like, for example, now there is this job as a prompt engineer that didn't exist a couple of years ago. So that is something new. And, you know, of course, whenever you have new jobs, I'm sure some jobs will disappear. But right now, what we're seeing is that humans are collaborating with these models, and the outputs are mostly hybrid. I think this part will continue for quite a while, where we collaborate with these models, and they amplify our abilities, our cognitive abilities, our creativity. And outputs will become more and more hybrid, the outputs that we produce in cognitive work. I'm sure some jobs will go away, probably the cognitive part of the job that can really be automated, and if that's someone's, you know, full-time job. And I'm also sure that new jobs will be created as a result. But, you know, even though AI is a new technology, this idea of, you know, human-machine interface and where the boundary lies is an old one. We've always built tools. We are tool builders, and somehow that has amplified us through history. So I think we will see a lot of collaboration between human and machines.
These are obviously very powerful tools, which is, I think, why we are seeing some folks say, you know, it's time to hit the pause button. One of the most prominent folks saying that right now is, of course, Elon Musk, who is an early OpenAI supporter. If Elon were sitting here right next to us at this moment, if we had a third chair and he decided to visit, you know, what would you say to him about this idea that we do need to hit pause, that it's time to stop deploying these models, because it seems to be an idea that is gaining momentum, at least in some circles.
So the idea of the pause, I think, is a little off, because we've deployed GPT-4 with a six months built in between, where we're just focused entirely on safety. So the idea of a pause assumes that we deployed these models, you know, without care and sort of irresponsibly, but that's really just not the case. You know, we build the model and then we spend 6 months trying to align it with human goals and intentions. And even now, there are several people on the wait list and we're rolling it out incredibly slowly, so we're sure that we can really handle kind of the limitations and the downsides. And the other aspect of it is that it is tough to build these technologies in a vacuum without contact with the real world, where you get so much feedback around what the limitations and the capabilities are, and you can take that feedback and make the model more robust and safer. So in that way, it's unique as a technology, and because it is so incredibly general. You know, I think this continuous deployment that is iterative and doesn't shock society overnight, like imagine if we went from GPT-3 to GPT-4 without this continuous deployment, I think that is very important to ensure that these technologies are built in a way that is safe and reliable. And you know, the other aspect is that x.ai now exists.
Yes. So there is a possibility that Elon is just trolling us all, I guess, is what you're saying.